Welcome to the Divorce Survival Guide podcast, where we have open and honest conversations about co-parenting, separation, divorce, and the hardest question of all, should you stay or should you go? I'm Kate Anthony, your Divorce Survival Guide, and I'm here to help you navigate some of the roughest waters you've ever swum in and answer some of your toughest questions. I've been to hell and back. And now it's my mission in life to help you get to the other side of this process with your sanity and your heart intact.
Hey everyone, welcome back to another episode of the Divorce Survival Guide podcast. I am super excited about today's episode. Today, I'm having a conversation with my dear friend, Amanda Steinberg. Amanda is, she's amazing. She's one of the smartest people I know, literally. She's founded multiple businesses in finance, media, and politics. In 2009, she founded Daily Worth, which was a startup focused on women's financial independence, and she grew its audience and its email list to 1.2 million email subscribers. After Daily Worth was acquired, she moved into politics as the lead digital fundraiser for Marianne Williamson for president. Literally, she was on Marianne Williamson's campaign team, working closely with her. How cool is that? Today, she's the co-founder of Hire You, a digital training company for social impact entrepreneurs. She lives in Philadelphia with her partner, Jordan, who you'll hear from in 2 weeks, two children, two stepchildren, and two large Maine Coon cats. And, you know, one of the reasons I wanted to have Amanda on the podcast was to really talk about women and money. Amanda also wrote a book called Worth It, Your Life, Your Money, Your Terms. And it's a great book. Highly recommend it. I read it years and years ago. It really opened my eyes to a lot of stuff about the way the financial sector is just, you know, run by men, for men, about men. I know that one of the missions of Daily Worth, which was her startup, was about sort of demystifying the financial sector for women. And it was a really fabulous, it was a newsletter, basically. You get awesome information in your inbox every day about money. The reason, obviously, I wanted to talk to Amanda about women and money is because so many of you struggle in this area. So many of you are disempowered. You may be being financially abused. Maybe you're not, but so many of us are disempowered financially. I mean, I am. This is something I struggle with in my own life always. You know, we've all got money stories, we've got money histories and all that stuff. And it's really important for us to untangle it. So I called one of the people that has been working pretty tirelessly in this area and from a feminist perspective, again, is one of the smartest people I know. So without further ado, here's my dear friend, Amanda Steinberg. Amanda Steinberg, this is so exciting.
This is a long time coming.
This is a long time coming. Thank you so much for coming on to talk to us today about women's financial empowerment. This is your wheelhouse. You're like,
this is my whole life.
This is your whole life. So, okay, so let's start with how you got into this world and the Daily Worth and like all of the things that you have started around this and your book, all of it.
All of it. The journey really started when my parents separated and divorced when I was probably 3 years old. And, you know, my mom, she was just terrified. It was beyond her wildest imagination that she would ever get divorced. And she spent about 10 years in a glaze. Mm. Because yes, it looked like financial stress on the surface, but really at her core, it was about her identity as a woman and who she was supposed to be and how her life had turned out and how stunned she was. And I remember my financial journey started probably around the age of 5 or 6. I remember so vividly when she grabbed me by my scrawny little biceps and said, "Never depend on anyone." And it was like this, that was how it was so clear. She was like, I never want you to end up in the position I am in, where I feel completely powerless. And so I became this very ambitious, determined kid who really wanted to, I was working and hustling since I was 12, 13 years old. And then what happened was I got married. I did all these things in a really short period of time. I started a company. I bought a big house. I did like all these things. I was like throwing money at the stock market. And I remember one day I got a $90,000 tax bill because my business, my software company had grown so big so fast, and I was having babies and all this
stuff. That's a big tax bill.
And I was like, wait
that just
a minute.
Gave me-
I have done everything right, including being determined to be financially independent from a young age. And I'm now $90,000 in debt. And, you know, it was a crippling kind of on the floor moment for sure, which I had paid off, by the way. It is possible. It takes many, many years, but it happens. So what I started to awaken to at that point was there's something going on with me that is prohibiting me from creating financial stability for myself. And so I went to take an in-person workshop. I remember I was 6 months pregnant with my second child. I'm like waddling onto the train to New York from Philadelphia, where I live. And I went to this workshop led by two women. One woman is named Leah Andres and the other is named Ra Goddess. And when I walked out of that workshop, I realized it was like a bat hit me over the head. I realized I'd been telling myself a story about money, which is that I'm a really high earner, which I was at the time, and I'm not a good saver, but I make so much money that one day I'll have enough.
Right, because if you don't save it, you're never going to have it.
And it was that, yeah. That was the story I tell myself. I'm a high earner, I'm not a saver, but I make so much money, so one day I'll have enough, which really makes no sense whatsoever, because it's very easy to spend everything that you have. But the big awakening was that the fact that I was telling myself over and over again that I was not a saver was the problem. And so what I came out of that workshop in discovery was I am now a saver. I have to become someone who is a saver. And it's that transformational process that you go through that enables you to, it's hard because you have to like deconstruct who you think you are, and you have to become someone who you never thought you were. That's the summary of my financial journey. And it was from that workshop that I launched a platform for women around money called dailyworth.com, which I grew to over 1 million women and sold to Jean Chatsky in 2017.
It's amazing. And part of the purpose, right, of the Daily Worth was helping women understand financial markets and finances because so much of it is in sort of like male jargon or like confusing jargon that doesn't have to be confusing, but like, right? Like,
well, it's actually worse than that. It's not just the jargon, because you can learn jargon things. It's really that our society has socially conditioned us to think that money is gendered, that men are more competent when it comes to matters of money, that women are somehow, because we're quote unquote nurturing or caretaking or et cetera, not strong enough to handle matters of money. But really, I think that's just pure sexism, the sexism that's in our society that keeps women in this place where we think we're inherently incapable and that it should be someone else's job. And even worse than that, if we become someone who is good with money, that we're somehow less feminine and less lovable.
Yeah. Let's talk about money stories, because I mean, there's so much more that I want to come back to, but let's talk about money stories, right? Because we all have them. And I think one of the sort of the beginning of women becoming empowered around money, which is really what this conversation is about and what we really want to leave people with, but is about our stories and about how, and I think that money is gendered is a sort of a collective story, right? We have collective stories and then we have individual stories, right?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, we have social stories, like collective stories, like money is not a woman's job. I remember when I was raising venture capital for Daily Worth and I was pitching all these mostly male VCs, they would say things to me like, don't you just want to be taken care of? Or women aren't interested in money. My wife just wants to spend my money. Like, this was the norm, not the exception. There was literally this lack of understanding among a very male financial services community that why would we even create services for women? Because they shouldn't even want to do it.
Right. Yes. Right. Why would you want to create financial services for, and of course, underpinning all of that is patriarchy and patriarchal systems of oppression. Because if we become educated around money, if we own our financial power and our financial worth, then the entire system gets disrupted. And that's not okay. Right. Little lady.
Yeah. And again, it's just like my mom, you know, standing there and with her glazed eyes when I was a kid. Same thing for the men on the other side of this is if we have to break down this story that we have, then we don't know who we are. Like, I don't know. It just doesn't make any sense. Like all the ways in which I justify who I am and think about what makes me strong and what makes me a provider and what makes me, you know, good at my job evaporates when you start to challenge these notions. And that's what Daily Worth was about challenging those notions, but more so for women in our individual stories. For example, I'm out of control or whatever, or I'm trying to think of some other good ones. There will never be enough, or saving money is selfish. Mm-hmm. That's a huge one.
Yeah. And I had one because I grew up in New York City where the idea, the myth of wealth. Like the most wealthy person in New York City when I was growing up was Donald Trump. So for me, wealth was, there was something really gross about it. There was something that didn't align with my values, right? So the pursuit of wealth meant that I would become something like that. And this was long before that man was president. Let me just say. Right. So for me, it was like wealth was sort of disgusting and you don't want to aspire to such a thing. Right. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And that's a huge, and there's so many different variations on that. It's like, people who made money did it by exploiting other people. And I don't want to be that person.
Yes.
And I don't want to be someone who devalues the things that matter in life, love, relationships, connection, et cetera. And if I focus too much on money or I become someone who cares about money, it means I'm deprioritizing those other things that matter to me.
Yes.
Here's my favorite part about it is women have been socially conditioned for centuries, millennia, to be the nurturing, caretaking component. So I call the good girl mentality, be a good girl, you know, don't be a lady, et cetera, et cetera. But what's happened, especially, you know, in the last, let's call it 20, 30 years, is that women have gone into the workforce at the levels at which we have. And there's this new mentality, which I call the boss lady mentality. So there's the good girl and the boss lady. Where most women are these days is they're stuck between the two. And that's where all the noise in our heads come from. One voice in our head is the good girl going, be feminine, be selfless, take care of others. That's your job. That's how you're wired. And the other side, it's like, be a boss, be an entrepreneur, be powerful, be empowered, et cetera. And when it comes to money, those two voices, they hit up against each other as exact opposites. And that's why women get totally emotional and break down around the subject because you don't know which voice you're supposed to be listening to.
So true. It's so true. And then when women are assertive, they are considered aggressive. They're bitches, right? So the pursuit, sort of the
hysterical, crazy. Mm-hmm,
right.
Right.
Right. Gross. What's your vision for women right now? Like from where we are now? Because I do feel like we're at multiple tipping points, I think, especially when it comes to patriarchy and like in any system, when the system is about to implode, it rises up and it gets louder and it starts screaming for its power, right? It wouldn't scream for power if it wasn't threatened. So
for sure,
what is your vision for women as we might be changing these systems?
Well, it's not only my vision for women, but it's also my vision for men. I'm so grateful that my partner, my love partner, Jordan Shapiro, is just publishing a book called How to Be a Feminist Dad.
I'm so glad.
Oh my God. It is so good. And it's really a vision for both genders where we are liberated from these preconceived notions of who we are supposed to be. And look at all of the science that shows that all of this myth in our culture about men are providers and women are caretakers and all that stuff is not scientific. You can just as easily prove the other side as whatever those arguments are. And so my vision is that we start to understand more about gender essentialism and neurosexism, and I have all these fancy words, but essentially that means that no matter what your sexual anatomy happens to be, has nothing to do with your personality, your character traits, or who you can and want to be in the world. And that we are, and I really see this in our children, the next generation, where we're much more liberated from thinking that we have to fit any sort of preconceived roles, and that we're finding partners and life partners where we're able to figure out what those roles are based on what our strengths are and has nothing to do with our gender.
So true. Amen. I'm so glad Jordan's writing that book.
Oh my God,
that man. I love that man. Yeah, it's, I mean, it's interesting because I'm writing my book too. And I've just been writing the chapter on feminism, sort of feminism 101, right? And that feminism is not anti-male. In fact, it is so pro-male, right? It like, men aren't happy either. This system does not, while it may support their power and dominance and control, it's actually not supporting them emotionally and psychologically. And in fact, it's killing them, right? Men die at a much younger age than we do. And the stress levels.
And they don't know who to be. They're lost. They're totally confused because they feel like they're somehow emasculated or, you know, it's the identity loss thing. That's where everyone is right now, is we're really confused about how to navigate this gender conversation.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And it's not good for them either. So when we, you know, for those of us who want to smash the patriarchy, we want to do so for everyone.
Yeah, 100%. Yeah.
So what financial advice would you give women right now going through divorce? And they're like, you know, maybe they've never been in, you know, in charge of their money. They don't know anything about what's going on with their finances. What do you tell them?
First of all, it's not your fault. You were socially conditioned to think that you're bad with money. And that is how everyone got to continuously take advantage of you for most of your life. And honestly, how you also got rewarded and praised for being a good girl in whatever form that was. So don't beat yourself up too much about it. It's a pervasive issue among women where you're completely blindsided by your life. And then suddenly you have to become a financial expert because you're responsible for your life. So just have some patience with yourself and realize that you actually did life right. It's not like you did life wrong. You became who you were told you were supposed to be. So that's the first thing. The second thing is the reason I launched Daily Worth and called it Daily Worth is I realized that because women are conditioned to be selfless and take care of others, we really struggle to save money and organize our money because that is seen as selfish. And so what you have to do, the next step is you really have to take a look at how you value yourself and work with Kate on how you build self-worth, how you learn how to value yourself, because you are precious and you are valuable, and it's going to be really hard to deal with money until you realize that you are valuable and you are worthy of having that money. So that's why I called it Daily Worth, because I wanted to connect women's self-worth to their net worth, because once you value yourself, you're investing in yourself, et cetera. The next is when it comes to saving money, which is really just the hardest thing these days, especially when you've got mortgages and kids and blah, 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 is you want to develop yourself into someone who can deposit savings once you get to that point, once all your bills are paid, and not spend it or not give it away. The result of having low self-worth around areas of money is that even when you have a financial success, like you get a settlement, you eliminate it from your bank as quickly as possible because you feel like you've become that person you never wanted to be. So you have to develop a muscle and a discipline to be able to have money, or else even if you do everything right, you're still going to sabotage it unconsciously.
Yes. Yes, I can confirm that. That was a huge part of my money story, was that self-worth piece. And that every time I got money, I would get rid of it as quickly as possible. I would either buy things or, you know, I would spend it in some way.
Or even like trying to pay off your credit cards too fast. Right. Like if you pay off your credit cards, if you just pay the minimum on your credit card, you're basically just paying interest and it's just going to continue to grow. It's going to take you forever. If you pay double the amount of the minimum, so let's say you owe $10,000 and the minimum is $500. If you just pay $500, that $10,000 is never going to go down. If you pay $1,000, it actually collapses to like 3 years. And so when you have cash, rather than like, we think debt is a disease, pay it off methodically. Don't try not to accrue new debt, but don't throw all of your money at your debt, because then you're still just exposed to more debt because you still have.
Exactly. Cash. Exactly. I did that. I did that a couple of times.
I mean, I still do these things sometimes. Like, I sometimes have to read my own book. I swear to God, I've reread it to myself like 3 times. Like, cause like these are really unconscious, deeply ingrained behaviors. And the social order is such that we are conditioned to take care of everyone else and not ourselves. And it's like, it's hard to change these core behaviors because they really threaten big, deep fears of like, will I be lovable? Am I a good person? Am I who I want to be?
It's so interesting being a single person, right? I've noticed a couple of like, there's two different roles that I feel that I have to quote play, right? In the dating landscape is either I'm not rich enough, right? I'm not successful enough, so I can't play with the big leagues, whatever the fuck that means. And then on the flip side is that I'm too successful and men won't want to date me because I run my own business and I have a house and like all of, not that I own my house, by the way, I rent it, but it's a nice house. And so I'm always like, oh, I'm not enough of this or I'm too much of that. And it's like, and those are my stories, right? That like crop up and I have to sort of talk myself out of and be like, you are exactly who you are. And no matter what is fine. So I want to talk about your book because you also use the word worth in your book, right?
Mm-hmm. Well, you see a pattern here.
And it's a great play on words too, but your book is called Worth It. And it's a great book. I read it so long ago, Amanda, I didn't realize like how long it's been since I read your book. But I remember in the beginning, there's a story about a woman who I feel like you even introduced me to at some point, who had been like super financially successful, right? She was like in finance, right? And then she got married and she sort of abdicated all of her financial responsibility.
Yeah.
Steph, right. And then when she got divorced, she realized that her husband had basically like decimated all of their financial funds, right?
Yes.
And so, I mean, you think you tell that story as sort of this cautionary tale and as an example of the ways that women abdicate their responsibility, right? Even powerful, financially powerful, savvy women who, quote, know better, do this, like abdicate this responsibility.
This is how powerful our social narrative is. It's way more powerful than our individual will, I think, sometimes. It's a force to fight. It is just, society tells you things about who you're supposed to be and how you're, and look, if you have a family with children, you can't do everything all the time. Like, it makes sense to have role distribution, but what pisses me off to no end is the countless women who tell me that they're like, I asked my husband to show me our portfolio. I asked him to explain our taxes. And he said to me, don't bother. You wouldn't understand it anyway. Do you know how many times a week I still hear this from people? That's, I'm sure many of you listening to this get that messaging as well. It is utter bullshit. You have to, and I think the point here, Kate, is you can't not know what's going on with your long-term financial security, because yes, there are countless examples of, I think of Barbara Stanley Hewson. She was the daughter of the founder of H&R Block. Her first husband not only gambled away her entire inheritance, but left the country and her with $1 million tax bill because she had to pay taxes on what he had gambled away. And she was able to reach a settlement and she's thought, but that was why she became a much earlier pioneer in the women in money space, was because you just don't know. People are weird and we all have kind of our hidden
100%.
Things.
Yeah. And, no, yeah. I know somebody who's a friend. She was going through a divorce and she had been again, like in financial services, like super savvy, totally, aware and all of that. But in their division, in their role division, in their marriage, he took care of the money. And when they got divorced, it turned out that he had spent like $30,000 on his mistress. And he had, basically wiped them out in all sorts with all sorts of things that like she didn't know was happening. Right. And so while yes, there should be role distribution,
but there should not be financial cover-ups, right? Or ignorance, right? Just because it's your job maybe to do the shopping, it doesn't mean that the other partner is incapable of shopping, or you wouldn't tell them that they can't go to the grocery store because they wouldn't know what to do there, right? Like you, it's not exclusive, right?
Correct. My friend, Michelle Smith, who's a financial advisor on Wall Street for high net worth divorced women, the stories she tells me about going through divorce where husbands will intentionally try and gamble away their money just so that the wife can't have it, you know, really vindictive stuff that she is basically had to build a whole legal arm and an investigative arm just to stop the sabotage because people are so angry. And because women have had been in what we call a money coma, not my job, I'm bad at it, I can't understand it, I don't have time to do it, et cetera, et cetera. It's, you really have to make sure that even if you're going, I know this is too late for some of us, and I don't mean to laugh, that was a nervous laugh. It's for anybody else listening or for our daughters or for our sisters, et cetera, there's this whole layer of it's a man's job. Men think it's their job. Women don't think it's their job. Women think they're incapable of it. Women think they're supposed to be selfless. Da, 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 that just basically sets us up to be completely screwed if life doesn't go yes. the way we want it to.
And in her book, The Feminine Mistake, right, Leslie Bennett talks about like really the I think you introduced me to this book, right? I know it was so long ago again.
No, I love it because actually Leslie, Steph, and I used to have these epic dinners, and I was just thinking back to having dinner with the two of them. We became like a trio. Yeah.
Aw, sweet. So I'm bringing in all your people. So, mm-hmm. But in her book, she talks about the financial, I mean, she really talks about the feminine mistake being abdicating responsibility and not just abdicating responsibility from understanding and knowing what's going on with your finances, but actually quitting work and choosing to be a stay-at-home parent where you now are financially responsible to another person. And the devastating financial impact of that goes on for decades.
Mm-hmm.
Decades.
Yeah. Decades.
Yeah. Can you talk to that about that a little bit?
Yeah. And for whatever reason, it also reminds me of some men that I know who inherited a lot of money and then made really bad financial decisions. And at the age of like 40 or 50, are suddenly broke and never developed, you know, a skill set to be able to earn income. Yeah, it's a look, we're fighting against a very strong cultural narrative that does not want women to be independent. And that's just it just rears its ugly head in like 80 different ways. And we have to fight it as best we can for ourselves and for our daughters and et cetera. I mean, like catch yourself. I even see this doing with my own son and my own daughter unconsciously is thinking that my daughter's future lies more in marriage. You know, I just like these thoughts pop into my head and I go, oh my God, there it is. It's still living yeah. through me. So I don't know. I'm rambling a bit right now, but
no, you're not. You're perfect. No, but it's true, right? Like we're so, and especially us, like Gen X, like we're in this, like, you know, we're the first generation we're not the first generation, but I think we're sloughing it off as best we can.
We're the first generation where the majority of adult women are single, not married. I don't know if you know that just happened pretty recently. 51% of women are not married. So it's trending in that direction. There's more and more, and that doesn't mean we're not in like relationships or what have you, but we are not legally married.
Mm-hmm. Right. And then there's also was a poll recently, right, that women in their 60s are like, hell no. And the men are like, what? Right. Because it works for them. And we know those of us who have been married, we know it doesn't work. It doesn't work for us.
can I tell you the best story? I want to tell a really big story of optimism for everyone here.
Yay. Do it.
Okay.
Yes.
So
yes.
When I was married to I'm divorced, by the way, we didn't even get to that part where mm-hmm. I basically recreated my mother's life in my own life. And I'm like, what? What the hell did I do? And so I constructed this life with house kids and the whole thing because I thought it's what I wanted. But the truth is I'm an independent minded, rebellious person because I was raised by a single mom who like shaped me that way. And, I realized into my marriage that like we were both miserable, me and my ex-husband. He wanted a wife and I didn't want to be a wife, it turns out. So I remember it was really, really, really painful. I'm, I was leaving our house to go buy a car because he owned both cars. I remember I was sobbing and sobbing and sobbing. Do you know this story, Kate?
I don't think so.
I'm so excited to tell this to you. I'm sobbing. I pull out of my driveway and I start screaming in my car. I'm never going to be with anyone again. I'm just not made for relationships.
I do know this story.
I am not going to, I'll have lovers and I'll have boyfriends and stuff, but I am never getting married again. I'm never, no. And I'm like in this rage and I pull up to the traffic light and I look out my window, and out my window is my best friend from when I was 11 years old, Mr. Jordan Shapiro. And he was like, Amanda, it's been 20 years. Jordan, and he's like, are you okay? And I was like, no, I'm not okay. He goes, well, do you want to get together and have a beer too early in the day and talk about it? And I was like, yes, I definitely do. And he and I have been together ever since. So the reason why we're together is he said, I love you completely and I will never get in your way. And I'm in a relationship now for 10 years. We lived independently until the pandemic. That was when we finally moved in together. I don't even know if you know, we haven't been super public about it because it hurts our brand. I'm kidding.
I know. I didn't know, but I think you said something about it and I was like, wait, what? When did they do that?
Yeah, this is the people. And we loved, our whole relationship is designed for the full person to emerge. And he actually, because he's a philosophy college professor and just wrote a book on feminism. So he literally has trained our three teenage boy sons to like identify misogyny everywhere it exists in our household. He does all the cooking and the cleaning because I suck at it. And he used to run restaurants. And I'm in a relationship now that is totally feminist. And it is so great. And he's happier and I'm happier. And we could do a whole podcast on this topic.
I'm still waiting for Jordan to send me his like clone or brother or friends in LA.
Oh, he's going to start a training program for men.
Good.
More like him because he's a rock star. So for any of you who are like, all men suck, there are really, really good ones out there who get it. It's just, they're an emergent breed.
Yeah. And I think that's right. Right. And I think it takes something for a man to, the problem is that masculinity has been defined for so long on provider status and dominance, right? Not dominance and control in like necessarily a negative way, but yes, it has its toxic sort of counterparts. But I think that the way that we've defined masculinity has been so limited that so few men really genuinely fit into it. And so many men aspire to and try to, but, I think men like Jordan have just recreated it, right? They just define it in a different way that works so much better for them and for their ability to be in partnership with women.
Yeah. I mean, because we feel alive and we feel free, we don't feel like we have to be contained. He and I have a very, very honest relationship. Like I was at a conference a few years ago and I drank way too much wine and I kissed a guy. And I came home and he was like upset for like a day, but then he was like, you know what? I don't own you. I don't control you. I understand these things happen. And he has his versions of that. And as a result, we're not hiding anything. We're not trying to suppress anything about us. And it's really like a feeling of aliveness that I'm so grateful for.
That's so great. I'm so happy for you.
It's
guys.
Cool. And I want to like spread it far and wide just so that people know that it's possible.
Yes, I agree.
Mm-hmm. And not to be like, I have an awesome relationship, which I am really, really proud of because I've never had one of those before. But it's the first time in my life.
Yeah.
But it's like, I don't see a lot of models for this. And I really want to bring it out so that people know that it's what's possible.
I think that's great. I really do. I think that's so important. And I'm thrilled. I love you guys. Let's go back to money. How did you mentioned your divorce and how you sort of recreated your mom's story. What did that look like?
Well, it was more like I thought I was marrying for what I wanted. I was marrying to create the life that I thought I was supposed to have. And in the meantime, gave up a lot of control and stability and put a lot of, that was also my fault though. It's I recreated it in that I ended up divorced and broke when I was like, my whole life is to not be that. And we could psychoanalyze that.
Right, right. What we resist, why we resist persists, right?
It's just a reminder of how powerful these social norms are and what they can do to you. Even when you think you're totally conscious of them, they can still run ravage on your life.
Totally. Okay. So what advice, I think we sort of covered this, but we could probably, advice would you give to women at this point? Like the women, you're in my Facebook group, you see these women's stories.
Well, so we covered some of the advice. Here's what to do next. Once you're like, okay, I understand that I am in transition from one mentality to another, and there's a lot of noise and it's not my fault because I became who I was supposed to be. And then you develop your self-worth, and then you figure out how not to spend everything that goes into your account. Like, don't throw all your money at debt, just pay like double the minimum, and if you add more, pay that, but don't develop the muscle for cash. At that point, what the next level is to get we all think that if we earn a good income, we will have money. Earning actually does not dictate how much money you have. It's your net worth. So your net worth is what you own. Do you own a car? Do you own a house? Do you own any sort of investment portfolio minus what you owe? What's your mortgage? What's your student loans? What's your credit card, et cetera? The plus minus that is a number. First, you want to get that number to zero if you have negative net worth. And the way you get that to negative net worth is really by becoming an expert in building cash savings, because that's the only thing that protects you from going further into debt. The next thing that you need to understand is a lot of investments that you think are investments, like a house, aren't actually positive ROI. I rent too by choice. We live in this gorgeous house here in Philadelphia, and it is way bigger a house than we could afford if we were to purchase something, because the owners fix the roof, fix the garbage disposal, fix all the things. And so it doesn't matter that you own a house. What matters is that your net worth is growing. So if you're putting more into savings, or you're putting more into your retirement account because it's cheaper to rent, absolutely rent.
Yeah. There's a myth about people say, I want you to keep going, but I just also like people say like renting is just throwing money, flushing money down the toilet every month.
It's not true. And like at all.
It's not true.
Because when it comes to real estate taxes and the cost of repairs and let's say you have a 30-year mortgage as opposed to a 15-year mortgage, the amount of interest you're paying on your house, like the actual cost of the house, you're paying half of your mortgage payment or whatever, or what your total carrying cost is also being thrown away. And the asset itself may not be appreciating in value. So the only way to really make a house have positive ROI is if you get a 15-year mortgage and you stay in that house for at least 10 years. If you can only afford a 30-year mortgage and you're not going to be a house for less than 10 years, it's not an investment. It's actually a real pain in the butt to take care of a house.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. I remember when my mom first bought her house, and I got out of my house because I knew I couldn't afford it. When I got divorced, there was no way I was gonna be able to afford the mortgage and then all the upkeep and everything. And I remember when my mom moved here, she bought her first house, and within 4 months, the entire sewer line backed up from the street all the way into her house. And it cost her like $15,000. Mm-hmm. And I was like, if that had happened to me, I would probably be on the street or never have working sewage, right? Like I wouldn't have been able to have done it. I would not have been
and
able to fix that.
There's always those things, right? There's always like boiler breaks. Uh-huh. You replace all the windows, and these are tens of thousands of dollars every single year of work that you have to do on your house. So in fact, renting in many ways is, especially if you're in a period of transition, is the right thing to do. To not go rushing into buying a house.
Yes. Yes. And especially if you live in somewhere like where I live, like I live in Los Angeles. Like the real estate market is insane. It's insane. Like I can't, there's no way I could afford to buy a house. I would have to move like really, really, really far away. And that would be.
Don't feel bad about that.
No, you know? I don't. But thank you for confirming.
Look at your net worth and pat yourself on the head and go, can I get myself closer to not having more debt than I have in assets? And then how do I really develop that savings muscle so that I don't go back into debt?
That's great. I love that.
No.
It's a great roadmap. It's a great roadmap. And it's so contrary to what people tell us normally, right? It's like,
I know. Well, that was why I wrote my book Worth It, is because, you know, I never aspired to write a book. I was really happy with like sending out a daily email to a million women every day. But what I found was over the years of running Daily Worth, that all the financial advice that exists out there, including like you should never have debt, you know, pay it all down as quickly as possible, doesn't actually work. And so the reason I wrote my book was because as someone who built a financial media company learning alongside my readers, I was able to really identify how the financial advice machine that exists today that everybody seems to follow doesn't actually work. Mm-hmm. And so the book is really all the things that I witnessed on the ground, both for myself and for our readers, actually did work. And a lot of people, you know, still challenge some of my core ideas, but I'll fight them to the end.
Yeah. So I kind of interrupted you on that house thing and like renting. Was there more that you were going to?
No, I was just going to talk about investing. You wanted to spend like a few minutes on investing.
Yeah, I do.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, I do. Cause cool. I want to learn. I don't understand.
Oh my God. I'm going to make this so easy for you.
Good.
Okay.
Great.
Ready?
Yeah.
So for all of history, we're in a strange time right now. The stock market has always gone up decade over decade. It doesn't go up year over year. And the most important thing to learn in terms of investing is for the long term, not for the short term, until you really start to understand the long term. And the only thing that really matters for the long term is your retirement account and college savings accounts, if you have them for children. There's two ways to invest for your retirement. The first way is what's called active investing. And the second way is what's called passive investing. Have you ever heard about this?
No.
Oh my God.
I mean, I know about IRAs and stuff, but I don't know about active and passive. I don't know.
So an IRA is a type of account, like a retirement account.
Right.
It's how it gets taxed and it's how it restricts you on like removing it from it. Active and passive applies to pretty much any form of investing, even real estate investing. All it essentially means, if you're active investing, if you're an active investor, you're choosing your stocks.
Oh,
you're
I see.
Choosing your funds. You're doing it. If you're a passive investor, you're investing in like Vanguard or Betterment, where it's a huge diversified pool of mutual funds. 99% of you should consider learning about passive investing because you don't have to become an expert. You just have to choose an investment services provider like Vanguard or Betterment are two that you can go look at. Vanguard is like big behemoth. Betterment is the .com version of Vanguard, and they're both equally great. And I have my whopping gazillions of dollars not at a Betterment. And and what you have to understand is that your money grows decade over decade. And you have to invest some of your savings for your retirement. Otherwise, you're gonna have a lot of trouble not working until we die, which is a big fear for lots of us. And that's really I want to take the fear away of investing and just, you know, make sure just understand diversification and risk. And that's really all you have to understand.
Right. Okay. Those are basic things that I actually do understand. I just hadn't heard those terms of passive and active. So yes, those are things that I do understand. It's like the stock market that I understand it, but my God, it feels like a full-time job, right? Which,
you know, so for a few years I ran investment advisory for women. And what I was kind of like shocked with when we would get their portfolios from like Raymond James or wherever they were coming from, I would find that they just had like three stocks. They weren't diversified, or they were in all equities and they had no bonds. And so it's like, you don't have to understand investing, but you do have to be able to look at your portfolio and say that's heavily diversified. Otherwise, you could lose a lot of your money. And some of these companies charge you like 3% if you try and move to another. They do all these really nasty things to keep you where they are in undiversified high-risk portfolios, because that's where they make more money, regardless of whether your portfolio performs or not. So that's the diversification. Hold on.
So would you recommend that, you know, when we're dealing with net worth, right, and you're kind of sort of getting, you want to get to that zero, right? Is that when you start investing and looking at, or do you take some of the money that you might put, say, towards debt and also invest? Like, is there a timeline that you recommend?
There's no perfect answer for this. I mean, if you were a robot, I could give you the robot version, but we're emotional beings and that's not really how it works. In addition, for retirement investing, if you have an employer match or there's tax benefits, there are benefits to doing that. What's most important is that you build, what's more important than either paying down debt or investing is building up cash savings. That's the first important part. Then you want to limit your really expensive debt as much as possible. Your mortgage, you're paying, 3.5%, 4%. that's not really expensive. That's, you can just pay, don't try and pay that off faster unless you like feel like you want to and you can. If you have credit card debt that you can't transfer to a zero interest card, there's no point in saving for retirement until you pay down that credit card debt and build some cash savings. Otherwise, whatever advances you make in the market, you're still going to owe. So it doesn't actually advance your financial security.
Right. Right. It's like you're earning 3%, but you're paying out 20%. That's not a net gain for you. Right.
Right. Exactly. It's not a net gain for you. And the cost of that debt is accelerating. And so you really have to have that handled. But that being said, many of us are afraid of what retirement is going to be like. We're fearful ever even know what retirement even feels like. And so if it makes you feel better to open up an account at betterment.com and start putting $100 into a diversified portfolio so that you can learn and you can see that money grow and know that you can't take it out, then absolutely do that. Just don't do it to the extent that you're really not allowing yourself to pay off debt once you're able to.
Smart, 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 smart. So, okay. I don't know. I feel like we've covered so much.
Income? Should we talk about earning?
Yeah, let's
getting
working. Yeah. Oh yeah, for sure.
Earning an income these days, it's really worrisome that starting your side hustle, doing a version of what you and I do is so glamorous because for a lot of
Look at us, Amanda. We are so glamorous.
I know. We're so glamorous. We're like living the life. It is freaking hard. You have to manage your own quarterly taxes, which is like terrifying. If you don't know how to run a business, you will have many, many bad months that could put you deep, 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 deep in debt. There is something about getting a job, as boring as it is, and having benefits and stability and a stable paycheck. Start your side thing on the side. You can do that thing, but do not start a business if you've never started a business solely to support yourself without some sort of side, what I call a bridge job.
Yes, I cannot confirm this strongly enough because I did the opposite and it was awful. It took me probably 10 years. It took almost 10, probably like 7 or 8 years to build my business to where it is now or not now. I mean, it's taken me 10, 12 years, right? And Amanda, you and I have known each other for a number of years and you saw it when it was in the beginning and like things were not good. And I went into so much debt for so many years trying to build this business that I have so much love and passion about. And I had a bunch of side hustles and a bunch of other jobs and it was just a nightmare. And I got to tell you, had I just gone and gotten a fucking job, it would have been a lot.
Well, yeah. They're not mutually exclusive. Like I've learned this the hard way too. I worked on a presidential campaign 2 years ago. And after that ended, I started my new business, which is called Hire You. And I had a job that I was doing invoicing for a corporation and it paid me like 10 grand a month, you know, and I did that for 9 months as I built. And I know what I'm doing, but I never, ever start a business because businesses require cash. Like I've never really launched a business without spending at least like $25,000 on like, you know, your initial platform and your advertising and getting it to where it needs to go. And you can't take a salary out of a new business. It needs the money in order to become something real that people know about.
Yep. Can confirm.
And so but there's so much glamour on like, everyone wants to have like the online course program and stuff,
freedom.
You know,
and yeah, laptop lifestyle.
And like, and there's all these people who like are like, yay, I had my first $100,000 month. And I want to be like, but how much of that did you actually keep? How much did you spend on ads to get there? How many months did you have where you didn't have that? And I'm not busting up people's 100K months. I'm like super freaking excited, but it's not the whole story, but it's being sold to a lot of women as the whole story. And I think it's one of the most dangerous things for women's financial independence.
I could not agree more. We do not fall prey and to the myth of the, you know, what our friend Kelly calls the female lifestyle empowerment brand, right?
Which you and I are both guilty of running to some extent,
but yeah, I think we're also both very conscious to not like, I don't sell my lifestyle. Like you guys would be really sad.
Right.
Like, you know, I don't live in a loft in Tribeca and I'm not like super skinny and I'm not like none of those things. I do not sell a lifestyle. I sell empowerment and answers and right. And this is actually part of why it took me so long to build my business because I wasn't selling joy and happiness and rainbows and unicorns. I'm selling something really fucking difficult. These are conversations that you and I had a few years ago. Like selling. I'm not selling anything, right? I am asking women, I want women to be happy and fulfilled, but like the should I stay or should I go conversation isn't one that like, I'm not selling love or.
No, I know. I didn't mean to bucket us in this category, but to an outsider, it seems like you are influential. You are in the spotlight. You do have thousands of amazing women and you are a model of entrepreneurial success. And there is a machine around us that promotes that anyone can do that. And I'm saying, yes, it's totally possible for you to do that, but don't put your eggs in that basket if you haven't done it before, because there is a dark side that no one talks about.
It's really fucking hard. It's really fucking hard. And it costs a lot of money and a lot of time. So by all means, get a job while you build the thing that you're super passionate about, right?
I just want to, you know, express my like deep sympathy, empathy, whatever that feeling is for all the women who are listening right now and who are in your Facebook group, and just acknowledge that it's really, really hard what you are going through, because you're dealing not only with financial pressure, but with a level of anxiety around a relationship that's gone sour, and you have to deal with all the personality disorders and all that other stuff. And I just want to let you know that there's a new you that is going to emerge from all of this. And it's not necessarily going to be fun.
Yeah.
But the reason why you can't see what your life is going to look like on the other side is because there's aspects of you that are going to emerge that you don't believe are there, but they are there. And that's what I saw in my mother at a young age. And my divorce was like a happy time for me, because I needed my all of me to emerge, and it was crushed. But so for those of you who are like in a really, really dark place, I would say, I see you. I understand, like, you've been doing everything the way you thought you should, and you don't understand how you ended up in this like cluster of, you know, mess. You are not going to be the one on the other side, a whole new part of you. And I hope that it's like invigorating once you finally get there. Just stay along for the ride and see what emerges, because you have permission to become anything that you want to become. It's like you get to now reinvent yourself.
So beautiful, Amanda. And I can confirm that that is entirely true. It was for me. And I always want to point out that, like, if you're comparing yourself to me or Amanda now, right, know that we were exactly where you are. We literally were. And I don't say that, oh, you know, anyone can do it, or I was exactly where you are. I was literally exactly where you are. And I think Amanda was too. And we've worked really hard to get to where we are now, but all of that work is available to all of you. And I love that you said, like, there's a new you waiting to emerge. And that's gorgeous. I love that. Thank you.
Yeah. Well, it's fun. It's like, I remember when my mom finally awakened, probably when I was around 11 or 12, we would just like turn up the music and like dance on the dining room table. It was like she became alive again. And that's what happened. You know, you go through these like periods and you don't know how long we're going to, but then when you finally say F it and you just like choose to become the person that you are, I know I sound like a really cheesy Hallmark card right now. You are going to feel a level of freedom where who cares how much debt you have? Like whatever, like everyone has so much debt right now. Like, who cares? What's possible on the other side of this is you are the only one who gets to define who you are and what your life is. And you don't have to be anything for anyone that you don't want to be.
Gorgeous. Thank you so much, Amanda. Where can people find you?
You can find me everywhere. So I'm Amanda Steinberg. Google me, and you can find me on Twitter. You can find me on Instagram. You can find my new website, hireyou.com, where I teach movement builders. You can find me. Just Google.
It'll all be in the show notes. So, but yes, or Google. Thank you so much, Amanda.
And you can find me in your group too. I'm there lurking and commenting.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, that's right. You can, that's right. Just tag her in the group. Thank you so much, darling. I so appreciate you. And I'm so grateful to have you in my orbit.
Me too. I'm so proud to watch what you've built. It's really extraordinary and so needed by so many
women.
Thank
you so much.
Thanks for tuning in to another episode of the Divorce Survival Guide podcast. If you like what you hear, head on over to Apple Podcasts or wherever you listen in and leave me a review. And don't forget to follow me on Instagram at the Divorce Survival Guide. I'll see you next time. And until then, remember, you, my love, deserve to be happy.